So, I'm going to start us off today by doing a little bit of an introduction, and then Allison and I will start having a conversation about her work in the music field and her history with as a musician. It's going to be a really interesting conversation. So, first, let me just start by telling you guys just a little bit about Arkansas Folk and Traditional Arts, the program that's hosting this series. We're housed at Fayetteville in Special Collections in the library, and we're partners with the National Endowment for the Arts and the Arkansas Arts Council, among others. We have three mainstay programs: this web series, our apprenticeship program, and our community scholars program. And you can visit our webpage, which we'll put in the chat, to learn more about any of those programs. I also just want to take a second to mention that one of my colleagues, Joshua Youngblood, and Special Collections is hosting an event tonight with author on U of A campus in the Pryor Center, with author Sarah Jane Nelson, who will discuss her book Ballad Hunting with Max Hunter, Stories of an Ozark Folk Song Collector. And in addition to performing some of the ballads and reading a few excerpts from her book, Nelson will discuss the impact of Hunter's collecting efforts in both the Ozarks and beyond. And there'll be copies of the book, signed copies of the book for purchase at Pearl's Books table after the event. So hopefully, if you're around Fayetteville, you can join for that. So now I'll introduce Allison. Allison Williams is a musician who hails from the Arkansas Ozarks. I met her last year when she was awarded as a master artist to work with an apprentice for the AFTA's apprenticeship program. But she began as a punk rocker before moving her focus to old-time music several years ago. So she calls square dances, she plays clawhammer, banjo, rhythm guitar, and more. She's toured internationally, including playing at Barbican Hall in London as part of BBC's Folk America. So she's also spent time in the field learning ballads and techniques of old-time music from folks like Violet Hensley and Tillman and Molly Pyatt, among others. And we'll be talking about all that today. So we'll go ahead and get started.
Hi guys, how's it going? I'm so happy there's so many people here. This is really nice.
Yes, it is a great group. So first, we're just going to start by talking a little bit. So tell me about how you got started as a musician.
My parents both played, but not seriously. My mother, she played piano and she taught music in like elementary schools. And my father, he knew about five Reverend Gary Davis tunes, but he could only remember one at a time. So music was always all around. There were always lots of records around, people playing music at the house, that kind of a thing. And when I was about 15, my dad bought me an acoustic guitar, a folk guitar with nylon strings. And he left the house for a few hours and came back, and I had written a song. So I was primed to start playing as soon as I could.
That's great. So how did that at 15 lead you to get involved with punk rock?
Well, I was 15. I was 15 in the 90s. There was a great music scene in Fayetteville, Arkansas. There was all ages venues. There were all different kinds of bands, and everybody kind of played together and supported each other. I started playing music with a bunch of different people, just all my friends. And I had a folk band called the Cat's Pajamas, and I had a punk band called the Affections. And then when I was about 19, I started playing bass and drums in a couple of bands, Catch as Catch Can and Devil Bean, with Dave Dean. And so we started touring, and that was my first introduction to touring around the country playing music.
Wow, that's so cool. So that was still when you're playing more punk and rock music. So what is it? What happened that sort of got you to what most people might consider the opposite to folk and old time, more traditional music?
Well, old time music was always around, and country music was always around. One of my first records was a Dolly Parton record. There was a dulcimer in our house that, I figured out how to play a little bit when I was a very little kid. But I was 15 and I wanted to make some loud, angry noise. So I did that. But it certainly wasn't just me. There were a lot of people who were kind of figuring out how similar traditional music was to punk rock music. I was at this big punk rock camp out. My friend Theo Witzel threw in just outside of Little Rock. It was kind of just like friends from the DIY punk scene, and we all came together and we were playing acoustic guitars around the campfire, and we were having all these great workshops, like solar heating and activist training and primitive skills, but mostly just having fun. And it was really wonderful just to have that group of people together and to have this idea that we can make any kind of music we want, and we don't need electricity, we don't need drum kits, and I think that was where I started really listening to Woody Guthrie. People were playing a lot of Woody Guthrie songs, and the first Woody Guthrie record I got was actually him playing old time music. It was him and a friend of his, and they were basically doing all these square dance tunes that he had grown up with in Oklahoma. I moved to Portland, Oregon after I graduated college. And again, great, great, indie rock punk scene there, but also a great old time music scene. I started dating someone that was in that scene, and I bought a bluegrass banjo from him for $50, and I immediately set to tricking it out for old time. So I put a fiber skin head on it. I put a really heavy, tall bridge on it. I pulled the resonator off. Put some heavier gauge strings on it. And that was the banjo that I played for, gosh, like the first 3 or 4 years that I was trying to figure out old time music.
That's a cool story for sure. Been lots of places. Who are some of the first, besides Woody Guthrie, who are some of the other of your first like early musical influences that sort of pushed you in the direction that you ended up going today?
Tommy Gerrell and Fred Cochran made a record together in, I think, the early 80s, that really has become really popular with a lot of old-time musicians across the world. It's just called Tommy and Fred. And the sound of it is so wonderful because it's these two old friends who know each other very well and know each other's playing style and how to play off each other. It's just banjo and fiddle duets. And that was one of the first old time sounds that I heard that really excited me. It wasn't until I was getting ready to leave Portland that I started looking into what old time music sounded like in the Ozarks. Before I left, I found a record at Michael Ismario's record store. He had a record store called Q is for Choir. I found this record in there that was Tillman and Molly Pyatt from Fayetteville, Arkansas. As soon as I got back here, that was probably like 2003, something like that. I looked them up, and Tillman. So they used to play at Mountain View a lot, and Violet Hensley actually told me that Tillman was her favorite fiddle player, bar none. He had had a stroke by the time I met him. But I was able to go out to his place, which it was off of Weddington, which now is kind of suburbia, but it was very much the country then. And him and Molly, his wife, had divorced and remarried, but they lived right next door to each other. And so me and Tillman would play out on the porch and Molly would come over from next door and they would bicker like they were still married. And got to learn some really cool fiddle tunes from him that I haven't heard anywhere else. Pete Howard came out for some of those sessions. And it was a really nice way to learn about just the culture and the vibe and the feel of Ozark music and kind of what's important to a lot of the local musical culture.
Yeah. Okay. So before we start really diving more into old time music in the Ozarks, and your career, I want to talk a little bit about sort of that intersection between folk music and punk music and sort of get your insights and opinions on that.
Yeah. Well, old time music appealed to me for a lot of the same reasons as punk. You know, three chords and the truth. Sort of a stylistically simple, lyrically very clear, anti-authoritarian, working class music. And I think that's true of a lot of people. I know a lot of punk rockers who play old time these days. And there've been a lot of connections over the years. Lauren and I had a little tech rehearsal yesterday for this, and I told her about the Roan Mountain Hilltoppers. So this is a great band, a great Tennessee old time string band, and they at any festival they had like the biggest tent and everybody under it, you know, everybody. And if they would see somebody walking around that, you know, had tattoos or was a person of color or they hadn't seen before, or they looked, you know, a little overwhelmed, they would say, come on in, sit down, have a tune with us, you know. And then they would tell you the story of when the Sex Pistols came to visit them. And so Malcolm McLaren, who was the impresario behind the Sex Pistols, and a lot of other kind of, you know, punk and proto-punk bands, he somehow or other got to know the Roan Mountain Hilltoppers. And he would go out there and hang out with them. And they say that at some point he brought Johnny Rotten and Sid Vicious along with him. I don't know if that's true or not, but I love the story. And he actually made a video, a very, very strange video of square dance. He essentially put on this avant-garde square dance and had the Hilltoppers in the video. I don't think it's their music that's playing in the video, but they're in it. If y'all don't mind a little digression, Lauren, do you want to show them a little bit of this absolutely bonkers video?
Yes, absolutely. I'll just say that it just says the artist is Malcolm McLaren on YouTube. I don't know. Anyway, let me share up here.
Yeah, the first guy you'll see in here is Joe Birchfield, who is was the original fiddler for the Hilltoppers.
Sorry, you can tell I was listening again earlier. Okay.
Brown.
Can we hear that?
I can.
Okay. Yes.
Brown.
Yeah, dig for the clam. Dig.
Fuck that hole in the old tin can.
Out the hole, you know.
Not the hole.
Not
the old tin can.
In the old tin can. What's the meaning of that?
Pardon?
What's the meaning of that?
I think we just lost sound on it.
Yeah, Lauren, we lost sound on it on this end.
Oh, we lost sound? Oh, no. I'm sorry. I didn't hear for a second. Let me try one more time. I'm going to go to like right here.
Knock a hole. In the old tin can. In the old tin can.
Good.
What you mean is that?
Pardon?
What you mean is that?
Hit it, maestro!
Rock.
Is that a good amount, Allison? You're muted.
Yeah, that's probably good. Good enough to get the a sense of just the how absolutely bizarre that is. And feel free and go and check it out yourself. It's on YouTube. But yeah, there's I think there's been a lot of crossover for a long time. I actually, my friend Cynthia Connolly, so she used to, she was part of the DC hardcore scene, did a lot of photographs. She's got a book called Band in DC that's all photographs of like the early hardcore days. And she started playing old time music, and she did a photo shoot at Clifftop for a magazine. I think it was Fretboard magazine. And she took a lot of pictures of just her friends who played old time music. And one of them was the guitar player from Minor Threat and Dag Nasty. And so it's just really wonderful to see, you know, how many old punk rockers are into old time music now.
I don't know. I'm kind of just spitballing here, but in watching that video a couple of times, and I just was introduced to it yesterday. I just feel like there's something really like sort of absurd and playful about the way that those two connect, in that like square dancing and punk, I guess, connect in that. I don't know. Do you agree? Like, is that part of the appeal? Like sort of that ability to make a little bit more light of life?
One of the things that I've found hanging out with old time musicians is that a lot of them differ from the people around them, in that they are very curious about the world. They're very curious about learning new things, learning about new kinds of people. So when they meet people that, you know, are very different from them, that they've never met anybody like them before, the musicians tend to embrace that, to have a sense of humor and a curiosity about that, that I think a lot of their neighbors might not. And that's one of the reasons why I've loved playing music with the older folks.
Yeah. So, yeah, I like that. So who are specifically, like, who are some of these older folks that you're talking about? Who has mentored you, that you can share about with us?
Yeah. Well, as I said before, Tillman and Molly Pyatt, really, really wonderful, and learned a lot from them. Violet Hensley, who lives over in Yellville. She's still alive. And she's pushing 100 now and still fiddling a little bit and teaching people how to make violins. So I worked with Bobby Fulcher. And Bobby Fulcher is the manager, the state park manager of the Cumberland Trail State Park. And Bobby is also one of the most prolific field recorders in America today. And he made some of the first field recordings of Clyde Davenport, who's an extremely influential Tennessee musician, banjo and fiddle player. He recorded Dean Delta Hicks doing ballads that I don't know if anybody had even heard in America at that point. But so Bobby essentially stewarded into being this state park, and it's a hiking trail. and it goes, you know, from north to south through Tennessee. And one of the missions of it is cultural preservation. So he's able to hire all these park rangers, you know, seasonal park rangers, to do field recording and to archive those field recordings. So through him, I got to hang out with Clyde Davenport. I got to hang out with, Charlie Acuff, just lots of really great musicians of the region. The Cumberland Trail has a record label that I believe is called Sand Rock Recordings. So check that out. Lots of good field recordings on there. You know, I got to meet a lot of great people at festivals too. Kirk Sutphin is kind of one of the greatest living repositories of Round Peak style old time music. He really knows, you know, he can play you the same tune as five different Round Peak banjo players would have played it. And he's really carrying on that tradition. And he was gracious enough to teach me some things just because I asked him at a festival. And Bill Dilloff is another great musician. He was not Southern, but he got very into 78 records and field recordings very early. And really spent a lot of time learning and making friends from, you know, tradition bearers at festivals. And he was another, you know, kind of repository of different styles, and another wonderfully welcoming person to, you know, like, here's this, like, you know, 24-year-old with a shaved head and tattoos. And he's like, hi, great to meet you. You know, let's play. So yeah, I think that's pretty wonderful. And then I was in a band for several years with Dave Bass and Tom Bailey, and they are both powerhouses of old time music in their own right, and who've done a lot of study and research.
That was in Tennessee, right?
So the work I did with Bobby Fulcher was in Tennessee. Okay. Yes.
Okay. So do you want to maybe play a couple of songs for us, and then we'll continue our conversation?
Sure.
Okay.
Is there anything in particular you want to hear?
Oh, gee. Why don't we take a request? I mean, if anybody has a request, they can drop it in the chat or unmute your mic and say it if you want.
All right. Well, the first song I'm going to play is kind of the first old time song that any punk rocker wants to play. So this is a song called Policeman, and this is Tommy Gerald has definitely done this, and it's very much a Round Peak song. But it, to me, it sounds like it comes a lot from African American traditions.
It cut out on my side.
Yeah, we're having that sound problem.
We're having that same sound problem.
No sound?
With the banjo, just like what we fixed yesterday. We did work on this yesterday, audience members.
Yeah, my settings are exactly the same. Not quite sure what the issue is. Should I just keep playing and see if it resolves itself?
I think it's what happens is every time you turn off your Zoom that the settings change.
We checked it already. Everything is exactly the same as yesterday.
The original sound for musicians is on.
Yes.
Huh.
High fidelity music mode is on. Echo cancellation is on.
Arg. I don't know then.
Well, I'm gonna back up from the mic and see if that helps a little bit.
God, that's so frustrating.
Well, police come, didn't want to go this morning. Police come, didn't want to go this morning. Police come, didn't want to go shouting in the head with my 44 this morning. Well, I got drunk, fell on the floor this morning. I got drunk, fell on the floor this morning. I got drunk, fell on the floor. It's good corn liquor and I want some more this morning. That police gun sitting on the log this morning. Well, the policeman sitting on the log this morning. Policeman sitting on the log. Got my finger on the trigger and my eye on the hog this morning.
It's still being finicky with picking up when you just play the banjo and aren't singing, but when you sing, I can hear the banjo and your voice.
Well, if you have any suggestions for me to adjust any settings, let me know. Zoom is not punk enough to handle banjo. That's what the chat says.
Yes, that's very true, very true. I mean, we can go ahead and try again. It seemed like it got better as we continued yesterday with the same those same settings.
I'm not really sure what to change, but yeah, let's just keep going on. Maybe I can just sing some a cappella stuff and play less banjo.
Okay. I was just looking on my side to see if any there's anything I can do.
Yeah, I'm checking my settings and double checking my settings, but not seeing anything. So,
I changed my settings to, so maybe I don't know. Maybe that will help since I'm the host. If it doesn't make sense, but who knows, right? So yeah, go ahead if you want to try to do one more and then we'll just pick back up our conversation.
All right. Jan, there is no noise suppression control on my end. I looked for it, I promise. I will try to sing you guys a ballad. So leave the banjo out of it for a minute. So this is one of the very few a cappella ballads that was known to be written in America, not brought over in some form from England or Ireland or Scotland or somewhere else. And this is about the founding of Nashville. And this is sung often in East Tennessee. It's called Cumberland. The day I parted away from you, in sorrow, grief, and trouble too, you gave to me your parting hand and wished me safe on the Cumberland. Then on our journey we did steer o'er the hills and valleys, rivers clear, through the barren place in the desert land, we steered our course for the Cumberland. We saw 10,000 human graves, all walled in with a mason sign, which made me think in the days of old, some human race has passed this place. When we got there, there was ice and snow. The wind it held and the wind did blow. It caused us all to weep and cry, saying here with cold we all must die. But thank the Lord, our health we found. We landed safe on the solid ground. In the happy land of the fertile soil. Here's milk, here's wine, both corn and oil. I have nothing more now to write to you. Preaching scarce and religion too. We're here in peace, love, and hope to be with the Indian tribes in Tennessee. My love for you, I can't unfold. It's like some lovely ring of gold. It's round, it's pure love, it has no end. So is my love to you, my friend.
Your voice is so beautiful. Thank you so much.
I hope you guys could also hear the beautiful voice of my cat, Daisy, who likes to sing back up. She's outside the door screaming her head off to be let in and allowed to be a star.
Oh, I hope Daisy has her big day someday, for sure. Okay, so let me get to my writing. The next thing I wanted to ask you a little bit about, unless you want to talk any more about, actually, I'm sorry, I'm going to go back. I wonder if there are any memorable moments or funny stories or just little things you could tell us about what it's like to be in the field, gathering and learning from people firsthand.
I don't know if I prepared any fields work anecdotes.
No pressure.
It's always fun. It's always a pleasure. Evelyn Sharp. She was Fiddlin' John Sharp's daughter, and she played guitar in his band on many recordings. Another great East Tennessee string band. Hanging out with her was always really fun. She was always really, really feisty, and she would always play an E major where somebody else might play an E minor. Like, for example, in Willow Garden or Rose Connolly. And she always had lots of opinions about politics, and we would talk about politics. And her family were Dixiecrats, essentially. She'd met Al Gore, and Al Gore's father, and liked to tell stories about them. So that was always fun. And Clyde Davenport was always just a delight. He would he loved to swap things, and he didn't really care if he got the better end of the deal. He just wanted to swap and trade. And so one time he told me he would swap me a Buckeye for my banjo. I said, I'm so sorry, Clyde, I have to turn you down. But he said, oh, that's all right, I'll give you it anyway. So I've still got this little Buckeye that I carry around. It lives in my suitcase. One time I called him up on the phone, and I hear him playing banjo. His wife picks up the phone. He's playing banjo in the background. And she's like, I asked to speak to him, and she, brings the phone back to him, and he picks up, and I was like, hi, my name's Allison Williams. I'm a park ranger. I'm working for Bobby Fulcher. And I was, hoping we could make some time where I could come out and, record you and play with you and all this stuff. And, and I told him, well, I'm a banjo player. I'd love to learn some banjo from you. He says, oh, I don't play the banjo no more. Clyde had just heard you. But yeah, he was always a delight. We had lots of fun on tour as well. That's always a lot more chaotic and interesting and weird. I started out playing my first old time band was called the Milk Crate Rustlers, and we played punk shows, essentially. Played punk shows up and down the West Coast. And one time we were staying in Bellingham, and then we had gone up just across the Canadian border to play a show, and I guess it was Vancouver. I don't know my geography. Whatever city is right across the Canadian border from Bellingham, Washington, is where we played. And my fiddler at the time, Maddie, he was a train hopping kid, and he he was really worried about coming back to America. So we went through customs, you know, in the van up to Canada. But on the way back, he said, I don't, you know, I've been busted for, you know, political activism and riding trains, and I don't think they're going to let me back through. So he hopped a train. I drove back to Bellingham to stay, and then, you know, kind of waited up all night to make sure that Maddie got across the border on his train okay. And right about dawn, he stumbled into the house.
I love it. Chaos on the road. So speaking of doing tours, you know, anybody who does a search of you is going to find out pretty quick that you were part of BBC's Folk America. I guess that's a tour or a program, and then you did an international tour. So I'm just wondering, how'd that come to be, and what was it like? Where'd you go?
Well, so like I said, after the Milk Crate Rustlers, I started playing with Dave Bass, who I'd met at festivals, and we started a band called the Forge Mountain Diggers. And so I went from, you know, playing punk rock tours and, you know, sleeping on floors and, you know, $50 in a bowl of chili a night to, you know, getting these big festivals with big guarantees and things like that. And so when that band quit, I made a solo record and started doing solo stuff. And I'd been playing a lot with Chance McCoy, who's a West Virginia fiddler, a very good musician. He was in Old Crow Medicine Show for a hot minute. I don't know if he still is, but he was in it recently. So they, BBC called us both up. I think it was just kind of a who knows who thing. You know, somebody recommended the YOs to them, which was this great old time kind of jug band, sort of Western swingy bluesy outfit that was really fantastic. And they recommended me and Chance. So we had just been playing as a duo, but we really wanted to put together a great band. We got, you know, the absolute best old time musicians that we knew, and they were from West Virginia, and they played with Chance a lot, and that was Danny Nicely on guitar and Amy Curl on bass and backing vocals. It was a huge concert. And just a huge fun party. Cedric Watson was part of that. He's a great Creole fiddler and squeeze box player. And it turns out that he also loves Hobart Smith's banjo playing. And so we got to talk a lot about banjo and Hobart Smith and all the things that we loved about him. That just kind of, the next step was to book a tour in England, because, you know, now we had lots of people who knew about us. So Chance and I did a duo tour over there, and that was fun. We go to the car rental place, and I had specifically paid extra money to get an automatic, you know, shift car, and somehow they just forgot about that and they didn't have any. So I had to learn how to drive stick shift on the wrong side of the road on the wrong side of the car. Chance drove a lot. And then I did another tour over there with Rachel Eddy, who is another great West Virginia musician that is worth looking up. So, yeah. And then the financial crash that was already really plaguing the music industry in America kind of took a little bit of a delay to hit over there. But yeah, after a point, the money just wasn't there for anyone, really.
Yeah. So, Allison's solo album was in 2008, and it was called Give Me the Roses. Somebody put that in chat, and something I wanted to say about your Buckeye is Jan shared that they say if you carry a Buckeye in your pocket, you'll never die drunk. So you're all set, she says. And that's just a really great little piece of folklore that I hadn't heard before today. So,
That means I have to die sober.
Maybe. you know, not as you get watch, older, Allison. Maybe you can just combat that. I don't recommend it though. So before we're getting on, I want to make sure I don't have any other. I wonder too, as you were talking, you said Hobart Smith and Wade, somebody else. I there's different styles of banjo playing. What are the styles that you play, and can you kind of describe the differences for us? That's right off the top of my head. Sorry.
I can try. It's okay. Very subjective.
Okay.
And I don't know if I can do any demonstrations really, but I'll try. So I would say, like, right now in the modern world of the internet and festivals and fiddle camps where people go to, you know, all learn the same tune from the same person, the most popular form of clawhammer old time banjo playing is probably round peak playing. And that it's not a style that I play a lot of, although I'm certainly influenced by it. And it's characterized by kind of a sort of a low clunking melodic sound. And you get a lot of that from playing right here on the scoop. So I don't know if you can hear that little chuck sound, but that's made by, so if you're playing the melody with this finger, you let this one sort of hit the string right after it to mute it, and it makes a little percussive sound. And they tend to do a lot of what's called like the thumb lick, which is like, so using this more as a melody string than a drone string. So like, so where you might go, you just go. So. So that's kind of some of the elements of round peak. I really like Wade Ward's banjo playing, and he's a round peak player, but he has a little bit more clarity than a lot of round peak players. But I also really like Hobart Smith, and Hobart Smith plays is very fast and very angular and very cutting. Very, very fun, weird stuff. I would say check out his version of Arkansas Traveler. Check out his patter roller. Just really, really exhilarating stuff to me.
Okay. So,
and no, Jan, I don't do any two finger up picking. I tried to learn it and it didn't go well. So I moved on.
So I also know something that we've not really talked about yet is, and I'm trying to add in a couple questions as I go, because I know we're not able to hear your instrument as well as we want. So, but what brought you to calling square dances and organizing them in Fayetteville?
Yeah, well, I as soon as I discovered square dancing, Portland, Oregon was the first place I ever square danced. I was immediately in love. I would go to, you know, some festivals like Clifftop, and they would always have square dancing every night. And the first time I went to Mount Airy, which is a smaller festival in North Carolina, there was no official square dance. There wasn't any official square dancing. They had a little plywood platform in front of the stage where people could buck dance. And I believe they did have, a solo flat footing competition. And so I got to talking to some folks, as you do at a festival, and I was like, hey, like maybe we could just like throw a DIY square dance, you know. The DIY punk scene was the one that I was in primarily for most of my time playing music. And so, you know, the idea of just doing something, just trying to get something done, was pretty natural to me. And so I was like, well, who can call? You know, and a bunch of people kind of halfway raised their hands. And it turned out that we had a whole bunch of people who really loved square dancing and were willing to try to call, but didn't know how. And of course, we had plenty of musicians to play. So we met up after all the contests were done about midnight. We met up down at the little buck dancing platform. And we all just started trying to call square dances for each other. You know, we were just trying to have fun and help make a square dance happen, even though none of us were really very good at it. It was a lot of folks from like the Chapel Hill, North Carolina area. And I was like, okay, I didn't do very well at this, but I absolutely am going to do better next year. I am going to learn. I'm going to get good. And one of my favorite astrological memes is like Virgo. And it's like a cat saying, I will respectfully be the best. So I've got that kind of grit. And so next year, and I think we all did. I think we all felt the same way. So next year we all came back and we had all figured out how to call a couple of square dances. You know, we just taught ourselves and taught each other. And there was somebody put together I don't know what you call it, a workshop weekend called Dare to Be Square. And that was the first one was, I think it was the first one was at Warren Wilson College in Asheville, North Carolina, where I lived at the time. So I was able to go to that and learn so much about all different styles. But I didn't have anywhere to practice this. When it wasn't festival season, I was, after that, I was living in Bloomington, Indiana. I was, playing punk shows and running sound. I'm a sound engineer, so that was kind of my job. And so I started calling square dances for punk rockers. I figured, the part of the job of a square dance caller these days is to teach these dances. And if that's your job, is to learn how to teach people. And if they're not learning the dance, it's usually on you as a caller, unless they're drunk or showing off or just, for some reason don't want to be there and aren't listening. You need to be able to convey these moves to them quickly and clearly. So that was fun. That was really fun and chaotic. And I was also trying to call for the contra dancers in Bloomington. And it turned out contra dancers hate square dancing and they hated me. There was one man who every time I would get up to call would make a big huff about stomping off the floor, to show his displeasure. But I managed to get some stuff in there. And so really by the time my record came out, I was touring, calling square dances about as much as I was touring, playing music. When I moved back to Fayetteville, I was able to bring that here. We coordinated our first dance with the Fayetteville Roots Festival, and then we kind of continued to do that. That was on, I think, the last Friday of the month, and so we continued to do it on the last Friday of every month. We partnered with Backspace, which was this wonderful DIY punk and other stuff, punk and art and everything else space in Fayetteville, Arkansas, in these little Quonset huts. And we kept it going up until COVID.
Okay, so that's awesome. So we're closing in on an hour. I have a couple more questions for you. And both of these are really, I'm looking to get your opinion, and I know they're subjective, but so sort of what do you feel like, what are you seeing? What's the current music scene, the current old time music scene or folk music scene in the Arkansas Ozarks? What's that look like?
Oh gosh. There's some really interesting stuff going on. We have Garhole Records here, located conveniently in the Quonset Huts where Backspace used to be. And Garhole has been putting out a lot of kind of roots-based music with a real DIY punk aesthetic. And Jude Brothers is one of my favorite, most exciting artists that has come out on that. It's really kind of cool. The old time scene here remains pretty small and kind of isolated, but we work with a lot of folks up in Missouri. And there's been a lot of scholarship and organization and fundraising up in Missouri around traditional music for a long time, more so than in the Ozarks. In the Arkansas Ozarks, it was kind of Mountain View was really the only place that you could get paid to play. I have started a nonprofit called Ozark Traditional Arts with Dina and Allison Langston and some other folks. And we are trying to do some of that, to be able to fundraise, to keep these traditional musicians working and playing and sharing their knowledge.
Yeah, awesome. Do you feel like there are, I don't know, maybe in like the past few years since the pandemic, that there are more young people looking to learn to play music in of any kind, or maybe folk music in Arkansas?
I'm not sure. People always find their way to me. People who really want to play clawhammer banjo, they somehow find me. I don't really advertise for students. But I do teach, and you know, as you mentioned, got to teach through AFTA, through the Master Apprentice Program, which I really recommend to anybody who wants to teach or learn traditional arts. My student Allison Langston was really dedicated, developed a lot, and at this point has played several gigs with me. And I love being able to create new opportunities for people who want to learn music and train my little horde of backup musicians for square dances.
So I sort of have the list in my head of the traditions that you keep as clawhammer banjo, rhythm guitar, ballad singing, and square dance calling. You can add to that if you'd like to, but what are your thoughts on sort of the future of where are these traditions going? What's happening? How do you see them in the future?
That's a big question. So much has changed just within my lifetime. The internet, smartphones, COVID, so much has changed about the way that human beings interact and the way that our society is structured, internally, the way that our individual connections with each other are structured. I think this is a time when a lot of people feel really confused and don't feel a lot of connection with past generations. I certainly know that there are a lot of young folks that are playing and care about history and care about traditions and understand how that can benefit them in their lives going forward. But I think it's hard. I think there's so much information out there that, finding out about old time music is, and it's one of those things that, we like to say it's better than it sounds. But it really is best presented in person rather than, in a YouTube video or whatever. So I don't know. I hope that people will keep seeking it out and finding it.
I like to think that they will, personally. Especially with people like you, with the ability to sort of connect punk music and folk music and I feel like a lot of people would probably consider you actually quite a young person to have mastered these areas.
I don't think of myself as a master, but I probably never will.
Right. Well, I do think of you as a master, so I'm going to comfortably use that term. So I wonder if maybe let's try for at least one more song, and if we can't hear it, then we'll open for questions after that. I would say Joshua Youngblood says that he asks if you repair instruments or if you're a luthier. Do you do any of that?
I do. I ran a music store, Maybell Music, for 5 years, and I repaired and restored and sold instruments and taught music from there. I have picked up my learning piecemeal from various places. I don't consider myself a tradition bearer in that regard. It's very much just scrappy DIY kind of had to figure it out, so I did. There are lots of better instrument repair people than me, but I'm glad to be able to fix, my own stuff. And it's fun to just take apart really old instruments and put them back together.
Okay, awesome. So yeah, go ahead if you want to try one more song at least.
Okay. I'm gonna push my mic back and see if that helps with the banjo thing. Let's see if that helps any. That any better? No, it's not any better. Okay, I'll just sing a ballad. So this is a short one, and this isn't really a ballad so much as a lullaby. This comes from Texas Gladden, but the first time I heard it, the bassist for the Forge Mountain Diggers, Meredith McIntosh, I was very ill when we were on tour in Sweden, and she sang this to me in the hotel room. Go to sleep, go to sleep, go sleep, you little baby. When you wake, get you some cake and ride them pretty little horses. Black and the bay, the sorrel and the gray, oh, heap of little horses. The black and the bay, sorrel and the gray, oh, heap of little horses. Little old horse, little old cow, ambling around the old hay mow. Little old horse, he took you, darned if it don't, said the old cow too. Go to sleep, go to sleep, go sleep, you little baby. When you wake, get you some cake and ride them pretty little horses. Black and the bay, the sorrel and the gray, oh, heap of little horses. Black and the bay, the sorrel and the gray, oh, heap of little horses.
Thank you so much. That was wonderful, beautiful.
Yeah.
So I will go ahead. If anybody wants to unmute and ask Allison any questions, you can do that. Or alternately, you can put questions in the chat. I'm going to scroll up. I know there were some things said as we talked and make sure there's no questions, but you guys go ahead if you want to talk.
Yeah. Okay. So we've got a question on chat. Can you talk more about the DIY culture and how it reflects your participation in old time square dancing? Yeah. Old time music is music that people just made themselves. They didn't, they would get an instrument from the Sears catalog, or they would make one, and they would play with the people that were close around them. They would learn tunes at fiddlers' gatherings and from their families. Later from the radio in 78s, but you know, the original way of you know, passing musical traditions in society was in person. And so that's something that I love. I love this idea that, you know, you don't need to be able to buy a bunch of records to play this music. You don't need an expensive instrument. You know, this is something that working class people can do through oral tradition, and it cannot be, you know, people have tried to commodify old time music and have for the most part failed. it just doesn't, it doesn't adapt well to being bought or sold or meddled with very much. And that's one of the things that as a punk rocker, I love.
Earlier in the chat, someone asked, do you think you'll ever do another square dance around Fayetteville now that Fayetteville Roots is on hiatus?
Well, the square dances were never part of the Roots Festival. We coordinated our first one with them. And I also organized old time workshops as part of that. But they weren't in any way, you know, in charge of us. They funded the workshops, which was great, but the square dance was its own thing. And, it was COVID that really, kind of tanked us. And we have actually been slowly getting back to doing some dances. We've been doing them up on Mount Sequoia at the, what used to be the old retreat center up there, and now it's kind of a nonprofit event space, and they've been really gracious about letting us do some events up there. So keep an eye out for that. May 4th, we will be doing a square dance at the West Fork Library Annex as part of our Shape Note singing weekend, the singing school. So check that out. May 5th and 6th is the singing school. Tim Erickson is going to be there, teach y'all how to shape note sing, and then all day singing the next day. And then, on the 4th, we're going to have that square dance. And we've got Pete Howard and, Brett Ratliff and, Nathan McAllister, I think, are all coming to play that. It's very
Virginia exciting. Shared a link to that event in chat. For anybody who's interested, you can learn more.
And the Fayetteville Square Dance Facebook page, we will post stuff on there as well.
Okay, any other questions?
Let's see. I was asking about punk folk crossover. Gosh. It's been a long time since I really thought about any of this stuff. You know, we used to play with a band called the Can Kickers, and I believe that they have dissolved. But if you want to check out kind of some of my peers in that like early 2000s DIY punk scene playing old time music, definitely check out the Can Kickers. Anything else?
Yeah. Is there a greater intersection between punk and old time music versus bluegrass and punk? And if so, why do you think that is?
Sure. And this is a rant that I could certainly get on. I'm sure James Rushala is just giggling right now. So bluegrass music was essentially a created music. It was created as a commercial music. Now, a lot of the kind of styles that you know, Bill Monroe, Flat and Scruggs played, were traditional styles originally. They came from that. You know, Charlie Poole has a lot of like three finger banjo playing, but just in a different context. The instruments that you see in bluegrass, you know, the banjos have a big resonator around the back to make it louder. The mandolin with the F holes was developed to kind of make it a lot sharper and louder. The fiddle techniques are very influenced by jazz and even classical sometimes. Bluegrass is what I think of as a commercial music. people didn't really play bluegrass the way that we think of it now, like around on their porches. It wasn't something that was passed through oral tradition. It was, so yeah, so as far as a punk rocker, bluegrass always seemed very intimidating to me, very, very elitist, very commercial, and just not as appealing. Who introduced old time music to the punks? Lots of people suspect Dave Bass. I don't know about that. I certainly didn't. I didn't meet Dave until I, you know, was already playing old time music. I met him at Clifftop. Dave Bass was certainly somebody who, you know, he was squatting in New York City, and then he would come down and play music with Tommy Jarrell. And he was, you know, busking in New Orleans, and, you know, he's got a million stories that always start with, it's one time in New Orleans. And so, you know, as soon as I saw him, I was like, oh, I know this guy, like, I know who this is, like, we'll have lots of stuff to talk about. And then it turned out that he was, you know, one of my favorite fiddle players that I'd ever heard as well. But I think that, you know, anytime you get a bunch of, like, dirty traveling kids together, you know, any kind of dirty traveling music is going to be appealing and fun. Like I said, I found out about old time music really when I was living in Portland. So I would give that scene a whole lot of credit for spreading the gospel.
Okay, so, are you working on new music?
No, next. I'm playing bass right now. I'm playing electric bass in a fun kind of sort of country goth project that doesn't have a name yet. But that's the most thing I'm excited about. Nothing else.
What about the hoe cakes?
Nope, not doing any hoe cake stuff.
Oh, bummer.
Okay. Any other questions before we? Okay. Oh.
yes, and vice versa. I would say more square dances turned into mosh pits than the other way around. But yeah, you know, goes both ways.
I think I would like to see a square dance mosh pit.
It's dangerous and messy and lovely.
Okay, so thank you guys so much, everyone who came and joined us today. This has been a really fun conversation. I'm so sorry that our audio wasn't working as well as we wanted it to with the banjo, but we got to hear some really great music and ballads nonetheless. Allison, thank you so much for your time, your energy, your knowledge. All of that, we really appreciate it and appreciate you. So yeah. Thanks everyone.
Thank you. This was absolutely a blast.
All right. Bye-bye.